because the special appeal envelopes did not come in, some parishes received double. We received zilch. But anyways, we finally got them this week, and you're very much aware of the Catholic appeal, right? That we make every year. In the 5 years that I've been pastor here, we didn't make it except once. We made it last year during the COVID, which I was very proud, because every year the bishop would call and say, "Well, are your people going to make it this year?" And I said, "You call it," and I say that. But hopefully this year we can do that. As you know, and as I hope you do, the appeal is very important to the church in Maine, because all these other commitments that the church has, according to the teachings of the church and the teachings of Jesus, there's a need for continued funds for these. And I just want you to know that the appeal especially focuses on certain areas that is most needed. For example, youth ministry. I don't know if you're aware, but youth ministry is beginning to flourish in our parish. I think we average between 17 to 20 youth when we have it, usually every other week or so, and that's good. And we do have the assistance of the diocesan youth ministry office to assist us in making it happen. The appeal that you will give to also assist many universities and colleges in Maine to provide what is called as a Newman Center, a Catholic center for the students. I know that Father Kyle Dustu, who is now pastor in that area, is doing an exceptional job in Oregon, and we're very blessed to have him there. The appeal assists the youth, the adults, the young adults there who go there. A retreat center in northern Maine, because there's a need for that. A Catholic retreat center, the Christian Life Center it's called, helps, you know, people of all ages, young kids all the way to the elderly, to come on retreat there. I remember I was director of Christian Life Center 30 years ago. I had brown hair then, and it was just a joy to know that was happening there because of the assistance of the Catholic Appeal. The deaf ministry is cared for by the appeal also to the Catholics around Maine who are deaf. The Hispanic ministry, a lot more Spanish-speaking people are coming to Maine, and we now have about 4 churches in Maine with the assistance of the appeal that is creating masses for those who are from Spanish origin. The hospital chaplain at some of the Maine hospitals, Bangor, Portland, Lewiston, they provide chaplains, Catholic priests to help out. Matter of fact, beginning of July 30th, my paycheck will come from the appeal. Remember that. Really, when I did that ministry, we were dependent on the appeal to pay for these chaplains and ministry in our major hospitals. Our faith formation, religious education, from pre-K all the way through the adults, with the assistance from people in the Office of Faith Formation, is a great gift to the church in Maine too. Prison ministry, a lot of the extra stuff that goes on in our prisons, which I've had the privilege of doing while here, let me tell you, it's because of the appeal that we were able to get some Bibles. Through the appeal, we were able to get some medals. I gave all the guys a medal of St. Dismas. And as you all know, St. Dismas Catholic Church at the prison is part of our parish. You knew that, right?
Yeah.
We're really 7 churches, and one of them is indeed the Catholics who get together at Maine State Prison. And it's a blessing to have been there. St. Andre's Home, an amazing assistance to young teenagers and young adults who are pregnant and don't know what to do. The Catholic Church is there through St. Andre's Home to help them to make a decision that will be life-giving for their child. And those are just some of the things, my friends, that the appeal gives to these amazing groups in Maine. If presence of the Catholic Church in all these ministries. I know some people give, some people don't, but hopefully you can, especially as your soon-to-be former pastor will be going to a place that will be dependent. I hope so. Or else I'll come back. You like that? Some of you. Now, I look forward to going back. We'll miss it here. But having served there for 4 years prior to my coming here, for 5 years, ministering to the dying and to the seriously ill is an amazing privilege. That indeed Christ, through priests and through lay people who work for the Catholic Church, their hospitals, provides some comfort. We're going to take just a couple of minutes. I believe that you were given a copy on your way in. Yes? No? Okay, some of you are saying no. There's a bunch of people there. And if you want to take a minute to fill out the form or fill it home and bring it next week or to fill it out and nail it in, if you wish. Thank you for doing that in the name of all who will receive your generosity. Stand, my friends, and let's sing together. Spirit of God, increase our faith. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Spirit of God, increase our hope. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Spirit of God, increase our love and charity. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Act of the Apostles. When the time for Pentecost was fulfilled, they were all in one place together, and suddenly there came from the sky a noise like a strong driving wind, and it filled the entire house in which they were. Then there appeared to them tongues as of fire, which parted and came to rest on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues as the Spirit enabled them to proclaim. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven staying in Jerusalem. At this sound, they gathered in a large crowd, but they were confused because each one heard them speaking in his own language. They were astounded, and in amazement they asked, "Are not all these people who are speaking Galileans? Then how does each of us hear them in his native language? We are Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, inhabitants of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt and the districts of Libya near Cyrene, as well as travelers from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, yet we hear them speaking in our own tongues of the mighty acts of God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Live by the Spirit, and you will certainly not gratify the desire of the flesh. For the flesh flesh has desires against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are opposed to each other, so that you may not do what you want. But if you are guided by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: immorality, impurity, lust, idolatry, sorcery, hatreds, rivalry, jealousy, outbursts of fury, acts of selfishness, dissensions, factions, occasions of envy, drinking bouts, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. In contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified their flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also follow the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
4-year-old Amanda had a fever prince took her to the doctors. And the doctor looked at her and began to look more carefully, and he looked in her ears. And the doctor said, "Who's in there? Is that you, Donald Duck?" And she said, "No." Then he looks in her mouth and said, "Who's in there? Is that you, Mickey Mouse?" And she said, "No, he's not there." And then he takes a stethoscope and puts it on her heart and says, "Okay, who's in there? Is that you, Barney?" And she responds, "No, it's not Barney. It's Jesus that's in my heart. Barney is in my pocket of my underwear." You know, what's interesting is who told her that Jesus was in her heart? Somebody had to tell her that. And whoever did were correct. But as she continues to grow, we need to know it's the Holy Spirit that will remind her and that reminds us who God is and how he does dwell deep within us. That's why we're here today in this Masses weekend to celebrate the gift of Pentecost. Pentecost means 50. It means 50 days after the resurrection of Christ. We have celebrated Easter for the last 7 Sundays because we Catholics need to know more about the power of the death and the resurrection of Christ, which is why we celebrate it for 7 weeks. But now we look at the fulfillment of the promise of God. When Jesus said the night before he died to the apostles around the Last Supper table, Jesus said, "My Father and I will send you another paraclete." Of course, Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit. And he says so clearly who this gift of the Holy Spirit is, not only the third person of the Trinity, but that Jesus says, he will remind you. The Spirit is one when we indeed invite him to dwell within us. He will remind us of the depth and the breadth, the height, the width of God himself, to remind us that's how big God really is. Indeed, Pentecost is the end and the goal of Easter. We look for that and we humbly continue to celebrate the power of the Spirit, because it's the Spirit who allows us to know even more deeply the Father and the Son. What a gift the Father and the Son gives us, and that we remember today. Indeed, we know what happened. We know that the Holy Spirit descended upon the apostles, upon the Virgin Mary, and upon the many disciples who were there in a fiery tongue. An event that brought great joy to them, so much joy that they could not keep it to themselves, that they had to walk out. The joy of the Spirit was so powerful that they walked out and began to humbly announce the joys, the name, the power of Jesus Christ and who the Father is with joy. To know that joy, to know that the fullness of God has been given to us not only at our baptism, but more deeply in at confirmation. And that is renewed every time we receive the precious body and blood, soul, and divinity. Because you can't separate the Father, Son, and Spirit. They work together, and what a team. What a team they are for us, given to us freely. That's why the mystery that we know as the Paschal Mystery is really the coming together of the vision that the Father had of saving us by sending his Son. You want to go down there and teach him how to love? Okay, Dad, I'll do it. And that's what Jesus did with his teachings, with his passion, death, resurrection, ascension, and now the sending of that very Holy Spirit that embodies both the Father and the Son for us. What a gift! Pentecost, my friend, that we celebrate, is really, it's the official day of the birthday of the church. Because those apostles and Mary and the disciples couldn't keep their big mouth shut. They had, their heart compelled them to go and to make Jesus known. They knew that they could not keep their faith in what Jesus did private. But to let people know. Let me tell you, if you're here today, most probably it's because somebody told you about Jesus, right? Maybe many years ago. Why did they even tell you that? Some of you, it's your parents, your mom and dad, who pushed through the church, right? What a gift they were given you. And for many of us, our parents are gone. But have you ever thanked them? Have you ever thought of thanking those people who dared to announce the good news to you? Thank God for them today. Because if they hadn't, you wouldn't be at this birthday party here that we celebrate the birth of the church. Interesting, just a few years ago, Time magazine had an article about Pentecost and all the churches coming together and celebrate, but they mentioned something very interesting. The article mentioned that there are 34,000 Protestant churches. When Jesus realized there would be a lot of division within the church 2,000 years ago, he knew it, eh? And why did he pray that night before he died? He prayed that they may all be one. Because it's the same Jesus. We may have different thoughts, but Jesus often prayed that night that they may be one as you, Father, and I are one, is what Jesus says. Which means that since the Reformation 1517, it means that 69 new denominations have sprung up every year since the Reformation began. So whose birthday is it really? You could say, or maybe let us say, that Pentecost is the birthday of the church that Jesus established 2,000 years ago. And we're the first ones, for there are many more churches. Because we say we serve the very same God. May we continue to grow to know the fullness of this God and be united even more. Our scripture readings indeed reveal for us and remind us that Pentecost is both an event of today and all the tomorrows, as well as all the yesterdays, because the main theme of our special readings today is the gift of the Holy Spirit. It is a gift that has to be shared. It's not only given to us personally, but made to be shared with others. Why? Because our hearts will eventually tell us, I want people to know what I know. I long to share this Jesus. To fall in love so much with Jesus that you can't keep it to yourself. It's like those of you when you've had your grandchildren for the first time and you had all kinds of pictures and you couldn't keep that to yourself. You had to show everybody, even aisle 7 at Hannaford, which was where we were. Oh, my grandkids, my first one, you guys, Daddy, and you just share and share. To be able to know that our faith in the concrete person of Jesus compels us through the Spirit to do the same, to be able to spread that good news, especially with the conditions of our world today. More than ever, our people need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ by you. He needs you, and the Spirit will help you. Indeed, my friends, when we allow the Holy Spirit to truly dwell in its fullness, believe it or not, we are giving God permission. Permission. Because we have the power to say we don't want God, or don't give me the gift, the fullness of the gift of God. I'll just take what I want. But when we dare say, come Holy Spirit, in your fullness, then we give him permission to do whatever he wants in our lives. reminding us to be good. Part of Spirit's job. Praying that we may indeed be open to it, a daily anointing to help us to fight against the temptations that we may have, the control that the evil one wants to take within us, our evil habits, even our addictions, to pray that the Holy Spirit may indeed open us up to giving us that strength. By asking the help of the Holy Spirit, my friends, especially to forgive. To forgive. Because that's the message of Jesus as he breathes the Spirit on the apostles today. He gives them the power to forgive. And sometimes there are some sins that some people we have a hard time to forgive. Great difficulty to forgive. That's what we ask the Holy Spirit. Will you help me to forgive that person? Because that's how God forgives us, my friends. You may have heard of St. Oscar Romero, who was Archbishop in El Salvador from the 1950s, I think it was, where he was shot at the altar and killed because he dared to bring the message of Jesus to the people in El Salvador. But he says something pretty important about Pentecost. He said, Pentecost will always be Pentecost in the church, provided the church lets the beauty and the Holy Spirit shine forth from the face of the church. It's the Spirit that allows Jesus to reflect from our faces to others. He's telling us that when the church stops to let her strength rests on that power from above, the Holy Spirit's power, which Christ promised and which he gave her on that day. And when the church leans rather on the weak forces of the power or wealth of this earth, then the church, my friends, ceases to be worthy of being listened to. We are no longer someone who is different when we stop leaning on the Holy Spirit. With the help of the Holy Spirit, the church can continue. Without the Spirit, the church remains a field of dry and dead bones. With the Spirit, we become alive. Lastly, some of you may remember Fulton Sheen, who's now venerable, which means he's on the process of becoming a saint. He says, even though we are God's chosen people, we often behave more like God's frozen people. Yeah, you go, Archbishop Fulton Sheen. Frozen sometimes in our prayer. Frozen maybe in the way we relate with one another. Frozen in the way we celebrate our faith. There's no need for us to be frozen again, because God continues to be with us. That's why, my friends, we pray for a new Pentecost. Personally, we ask God to give us a new Pentecost within. We ask God to give a new Pentecost within all people from our parish. We may become new and alive and alert and announcers of the good news. Come, Holy Spirit. Humble pride to stand. We profess our belief in this. this very God of ours. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages,
God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess for baptism and forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We have heard your word, Lord. We continue to see and receive the invitation of your precious Holy Spirit. And now we ask you, Lord, to listen to our words of deed and to respond to them.
For the church, that renewed in the Holy Spirit, we may always seek unity as one body in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who provide public safety, that they are treated and, in turn, treat everyone they encounter with respect, compassion, and dignity. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the most recent Israeli-Palestinian violence in the Middle East, that the Holy Spirit prompt leaders and citizens to work together to bring lasting peace to this region. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have lost hope, the single parent working two jobs, the homeless person living on the streets, the prisoner serving a life sentence, the chronically ill patient, that they may be comforted through the work of the Holy Spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who suffer discrimination, persecution, and marginalization, that they may be treated with fairness and kindness, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace this week to live with the joy and peace given to us by the Holy Spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially those who have experienced great suffering in their last days, that they have peace and rest in God's presence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
This Mass is being offered for Pro Pueblo. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we also pray in thanksgiving, Lord, for all the Christian churches in the Belfast area who announce your good news and our good news for others. For them we pray to the
Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
We take a moment, Lord, to lift up to you the stillness of our hearts, our own personal intentions. Pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And yes, Heavenly Father, we believe that you will answer us, for we pray in the precious name of your Son, Jesus the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. for others that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for all of his holy church.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that as promised by your Son, the Holy Spirit may reveal to us more abundantly the hidden mystery of the sacrifice, and graciously lead us into all truth through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for bringing your paschal mystery to completion. You bestow the Holy Spirit today on those you made your adopted children by uniting them to your only begotten Son. The same Spirit as the Church came to birth, opened to all peoples the knowledge of God, and brought together the many languages of the earth in profession of the one faith. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
For this is my body, which will be.
chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, and in accordance with your will live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord Jesus be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of his peace. spiritual communion. I invite you to pray this prayer, and we will pray it also for you. My Jesus, I believe that you are present.
I believe that you are present.
In the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist.
In the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist.
I love you.
Above all things.
And I desire to receive you. Into my soul.
Since I cannot at this moment.
Receive you sacramentally.
Come at least spiritually.
Into my heart.
I embrace you.
As if you were already there. And unite myself wholly to you.
Never permit me
to be separated from you.
Thank you.
pray. O God, who bestow heavenly gifts upon your church, safeguard, we pray, the grace you have given, that the gift of the Holy Spirit poured out upon her may retain all its force, and that this spiritual food may gain her abundance of eternal redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray to Saint Michael.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
And again, just to let you know, every Thursday, the Bishop Dealey, and the priest of our diocese and its staff, we go through like Zoom, and we meet with the bishop live. He's in his conference room and at the chancery. He's spoken this Thursday in light of what has been given to us concerning the changes, and he wants you to know that how this will affect the church in Maine. First of all, you need to know that not one case of COVID originated in the Catholic Church in Maine. Not one case. So that's good news. And that is because we did what we were called to do. But beginning on May 24th, in our state, of course, but also in all our churches, masks will no longer be required in church. So I want you to know that. You may have heard that. Capacity limits, contact tracing information that we should take, no more of that. There'll be all pews will be available. There'll be no more ribbons. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
right? And also, those of you who are Eucharistic ministers and who bring communion to the homebound or to some of our nursing homes in the area, you now have permission to begin doing that. But make sure you ask permission from the person who wants to receive. Ask them what they want. But keep in mind all this stuff, my friends. I'm glad that we're going back to some normalcy. I know that the bishop did say, for those who still want to wear the mask in church, nothing wrong with that. He did express some concerns of families coming back, especially younger than 11 years old who aren't being vaccinated. And so keep that in mind as you discern and make your decision. Because we certainly want our young families to start coming back and themselves feeling safe. My friends, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Happy birthday, Church.
Happy birthday.
I'm glad you're excited. Hallelujah.